Well, good afternoon, everyone. I'm Laura Coates, and I'm so glad you're with us today for a really special edition of CNN Citizen. This about Roe v. Wade, what happens next? Now, as you can imagine, this is a very interesting and debated issue that's been all over the news, and we're going to continue to talk about all the things that matter to each of you in particular. I do want to encourage you to join the conversation. It's best when it's infused with your insight and your engagement as well. So chat your question to the right of the screen. There's a little box for you there. We're going to incorporate you into the conversation because that's what's important here. And with this bombshell leak of Justice Alito's draft, not final, but draft opinion of a very contentious issue coming out of Mississippi that has national ramifications, there has been a lot to talk about here. And I've got a dynamite panel who are the best at breaking all of this down. So joining me now is David Chalian. He, of course, is CNN's vice president of political coverage and also political director. We have Fatima Goss Graves. Welcome to this as well. She's president and CEO of the National Women's Law Center and president of the National Women's Law Center Action Fund, also the co-founder of the Time's Up Legal Defense Fund. And we've got Manu Raju as well. He is the CNN chief congressional correspondent. A lot to talk with all of you about and really lean into your wheelhouses. I want to begin with you, Fatima, because give us the big picture. We have had a little, maybe around 48 hours in many respects to sort of process the probability of this maybe being a final opinion. But the work you have done really has been contemplating this for quite some time. Tell me about the big picture in terms of what impact this decision, if final, would really have.
Well, thanks so much for having me. The first thing I want to make sure people understand is that abortion is still legal in this country. This was a draft leaked opinion. This is not yet in effect. And so I want to make sure anyone who's tuning in understands that. But if Justice Alito's decision were to be the final decision, or actually if anything close to Justice Alito's decision were to be the final decision, we would be in a situation where 50 years of precedent would be overturned and access to abortion care would be a disaster in this country, which would create both a public health crisis of a magnitude we have not seen. And also, I think a legal crisis and a crisis around the legitimacy of this court. 26 states joined Mississippi to ask the court to overturn Roe. Many states have what we call trigger laws on their books, where the moment the court says that Roe is not the law, a law banning abortion and in some cases criminalizing doctors and criminalizing patients would go into effect. And it would create havoc on the states who are trying to expand access as people dramatically tried to move to get the care they needed. And I guess the last thing that I will say is this, the question really at stake is whether or not abortion will be legal in this country. People will continue to get abortion care. And the question is the conditions on which they do it and who it falls hardest on. And in this case, what we know it is that Black and Brown women who are disproportionately in the states that have been racing to ban abortion, those who don't have income and can't travel, those who live in rural areas and are already traveling too far to get the care they need, or those who already don't have good access to healthcare, that's who's going to be the hardest hit in this situation.
You know, it's important to really, as you did, unpack that and not to conflate what I think oftentimes people think about, the idea that abortion somehow became legal in 1973 with Roe v. Wade, and that somehow that meant that abortions were started in this country at that year. They were going on before that. It was in the press. It was in the courts because this issue was obviously controversial and much, you know, legislation about it and litigation about it. And so it's not that it's going to stop entirely, but the access to it, perhaps, who will have the luxury of being able to travel and get the care. And interesting as well, David, because as she's articulating these thoughts about how there are certain areas of the country that are going to be hardest hit and disproportionate impact on Black and Brown communities, there's a bit of an overlap of a political map that might start to pop up. And you know that quite well.
Yeah, I mean, it is probably some of the areas represented by some of the most vociferous anti-abortion rights, pro-life advocates may be hardest hit by this, right? I mean, it is in this large swath of red America where this will be felt most acutely as this issue should indeed, this be the final opinion issued by the court, which again is a good caveat that that is not where we are at the moment, should it be, having it returned to the states means that there is going to be just a very different experience for people who live in sort of coastal blue America than people who live in the swath of the great middle of red America. And of course, great difference between those who have means to travel to those places versus those that don't. So, and it just, it's interesting because it conversely probably deals with the fact that the people who, the representatives, senators, activists who have fought for these 50 years to achieve this moment of seeing Roe versus Wade overturned, you know, come from and represent areas that may be hardest hit by this decision.
Let me stick there for a second, because I want to get an understanding for people about whether this is indeed a controversial issue in terms of polling in particular, David, because you know, you're thinking about what the Supreme Court might be doing. And I, again, we can't echo it enough. This is a, not a final opinion. The Chief Justice himself authenticated this particular document as a draft opinion, circulated back in February. We know that it is currently May. A lot has probably taken place and maybe still more, but it in fact was a draft. And the fact that it was out there for people is very concerning for some and one and cause for a celebration for still others. But in terms of the polling and what it tells us, David, is abortion and abortion access and reproductive rights, is this a real political wedge issue or one that's pretty settled about how people feel?
Well, the broad question about Roe v. Wade and its protections is a 70-30 issue, meaning 70% of the country would like to see Roe v. Wade upheld. If indeed the court issues Alito's opinion as is, the court will be taking a position that is a clear minority position, a 30% position in terms of most of the polling. I will note, though, the polling also indicates a range of responses across a range of different slices of this issue. So the American people are broadly popular of some restrictions on abortion, you know, in terms of talking about late-term abortions and what have you. That polling, when you say, well, should there be any restrictions put in place at all on access to abortion, the American people actually do favor that. But the idea of getting rid of Roe is just a wholly unpopular idea in the American electorate.
Well, speaking of the idea of the minority viewpoint, the majority viewpoint, I want to envelop you into the conversation, Manu, because you are our chief congressional correspondent. You're well aware of the power dynamic and the power, frankly, of the minority vote, especially when it comes to Republicans and Democrats. And so while the polling of the electorate might suggest something, well, the President of the United States has spoken about codifying Roe v. Wade. There's been a lot of discussion in the last 24 hours about that. It's happened before, though, right? The idea of essentially trying to codify it. Are there the votes? Is there a prospect to be able to, if this is the final opinion, codify Roe v. Wade nonetheless?
There's really no path in this current Congress, and there are a few reasons why. One, there just are not, the Democrats are not totally united about how to deal with the issue of abortion. While this is a vastly an abortion rights supporting caucus, there are a couple of Democrats who are abortion opponents. One is Joe Manchin, the senator we talk about so much about. He opposes abortion rights. Now, there's also Senator Bob Casey of Pennsylvania. He does support the right to codify abortion as a right into law, but he does support restrictions on abortion. So there's not unanimity on that. We're in a 50-50 Senate also, so there is a significant math problem for Democrats. In order to get any legislation through under the current rules of the Senate, you need to have 60 votes to overcome a filibuster. And in the 50-50 Senate, that is simply not going to happen. The only Republicans who do support abortion rights here are Susan Collins of Maine, and Lisa Murkowski of Alaska. Those are two have been swing votes, and some of these justices as well. Collins, of course, was that key decisive vote, her along with Manchin, and getting Kavanaugh onto the bench. She voted against Amy Coney Barrett. Lisa Murkowski voted against Brett Kavanaugh. But those two senators oppose the Democrats' main bill on this issue right now. There's a sweeping bill to essentially ensure that women have preserve the right and access to an abortion. That bill had already come up for a vote in February in the Senate. Those two senators, those Republican senators, opposed it. Joe Manchin opposed it. There were not 50 votes in the Senate, much less 60 votes to overcome a filibuster. And the Democratic leadership still wants to move forward next week on a bill that's similar to that broad bill that failed in February with some changes. But those changes are not going to be enough to get a majority, let alone a supermajority in the Senate. So the best hope for Democrats right now is that they pick up more seats in the midterm elections, then allows them to have enough votes to essentially change the Senate filibuster rules, because that requires also a simple majority if they were to try to change the rules along straight party lines. But Manchin and Kyrsten Sinema right now oppose changing the filibuster rules. So maybe they get a 53-47 Senate if they're very, very lucky and having to exceed expectations on election day. And then they would have to, of course, hold the House as well. And the House is at risk, a serious risk of flipping to the Republicans. So they got to keep the House, gain some seats in the Senate. And then next year would be their opportunity to codify the right for an abortion into law. So you can see, Laura, how difficult that would be. Right now, there's not the math. There's not the path, but we'll see what happens after November.
You know how at the end of the year, they always do the sort of most widely used word of the year. I bet it's always going to be Manchin over the next 4 years of this presidency. I bet it's always going to be that word, because it always comes up as a senator.
Especially if it's a 50-50 Senate again.
Especially if it's a 50-50 Senate again. I want to dig a little deeper in that, because I'm not hearing a lot about this bill, Manu, and you're the right person to talk about this, because the new asks that they're trying to incorporate into the bill, what about those new asks would be things that would be what a Republican might have an aversion to? Are there some compromises to be made, or is the timeline that you speak of really making this a bit of a fool's errand?
Well, there's the politics and there's the policy here. The Democratic leadership doesn't have much of an incentive to get into a long negotiation with Senators Lisa Murkowski and Susan Collins, the only two potential gettable votes on this bill, because if they were to get them, and say Manchin were to get on a narrower version of this bill, then they were only still going to be, let's say, 8 votes short of needing to break a filibuster. And if you're Chuck Schumer and there's no love lost between Chuck Schumer and Susan Collins, you probably don't want to go out of your way to give Susan Collins a vote for political cover, essentially, in the aftermath of what happened in this draft opinion and her support of Brett Kavanaugh, in which she believed that Brett Kavanaugh was not gonna overturn Roe v. Wade and respect that precedent to give her some sort of political cover. So that's the raw sheer politics, okay, which plays into all of this. Then there is the policy, and there is some discussion about from those senators, Murkowski and Collins, about trying to make a narrower bill than the larger bill to essentially assure that all women preserves their right to access an abortion. They want some changes. They've discussed some different things. But again, there is not a serious negotiation going on that could potentially lead to broader support. We'll see ultimately where they come down next week, when they're talking about making some modifications, slight modifications to the bill that passed in February. Yeah. But probably not a whole lot to get much more support.
Well, if you think about that, Fatima, the idea of what's happening in Congress and the process, and of course, the bureaucracy is not known for its expedience by any stretch of the imagination on even issues that are not the 70-30 that David was speaking about. I want to bring in a question, because it really alludes to what was referenced by Manu and what is talked about by Senator Susan Collins, Senator Lisa Murkowski, about what the Supreme Court nominees had to say. And I know the work that you do, you watch very closely about the composition of the court, because if the buck is to stop there, the ideology on the court, the philosophies, the forthrightness and candor is going to make all the difference in being able to support or oppose. And so there was a question from Michael in California who asked, and I want to expand past this, since the last three President Trump appointees all said Roe was settled law, since this leak and they're poised to overturn, doesn't that make them liable for perjury? Now, of course, there is some, you know, the court of public opinion, what it means to lie, the idea of hedging in a confirmation process or a court of law, let alone a hearing. What do you make of the sort of about face that some are claiming when it comes to Supreme Court justices? Now, they, of course, would say, as you know, Fatima, no, I was just trying not to do the old Bork. I wanted to hedge. What do you say?
Well, I think the public is probably looking at this situation and thinking our process for nominating and confirming justices might be broken. And that is a giant disappointment coming off the historic nomination and confirmation of Judge Ketanji Brown Jackson to the Supreme Court, which I think was a real window into the process, but also highlighted other things that are very, very much broken with this process. So it's not enough for you to just say and repeat that Roe is settled law if you are like Justice Alito and have 80 pages of ideas in your head that say the opposite. And so I think people will be frustrated by this, whether or not it meets some technical requirement or perjury or not. It causes distrust with the Supreme Court and the very process, which is a worse thing in my view for the Supreme Court, which relies on its legitimacy in order to maintain its important feature of the democracy. And if I could just say one more thing, as I was listening closely to what Manu said, and I actually, there's not some giant divide in the Democratic caucus on their support for Roe or their support for the Women's Health Protection Act, which Leader Schumer has said he will bring up, right? It has already passed the House. And all but Senator Manchin, in terms of the Democratic Party, voted in support of it when it was on the floor. So that's actually not a giant divide. And I actually think in this moment, when you put together both the challenge we have of the court and the three Trump justices who have dramatically changed the court, plus who it is that is actually blocking. So even if we get Lisa Murkowski and Susan Collins, if we get those senators, your point is very well taken that you need 60 to move anything. And that actually opens a broader conversation of whose responsibility is it. In this country, on a 70-30 issue, as you have pointed out, where the vast majority of people, including Democrats and Republicans, do not believe that this is how people should be spending their time, our representation does not actually match the reality of people in this country.
You know, on that point, the reality is, yeah, I would love for you, David, to do that, because I see you and you nodding your head, and I know you've got your head for numbers about what the people have said. What do you respond to that?
Well, no, I wanted to go to where Fatima first started answering the viewer's question about the process, because I think if you go back and look at every time we begin to cover a Supreme Court confirmation process, you will hear the expression kabuki theater in almost like every hour of coverage around. And what we mean by that is that everybody has their rehearsed roles. The senators have their rehearsed roles of exactly which questions they're going to ask, that they know they're going to get these completely rehearsed answers so carefully and skillfully written so as to not actually answer the question they're looking for. And the senator knows that going into it. And everybody sort of plays their part, and it doesn't serve the actual function of drawing out from the nominee how they're going to approach this issue and other issues that they get asked about before the court. So everyone just plays these rehearsed roles, which is why you get Brett Kavanaugh and Gorsuch, and even to the point of even in the most recent hearings, not on this issue, but on others, about Ketanji Brown Jackson, you get these answers that are deliberately created so as not to box them in, nor to reveal what they would actually do. And this is, and so the value of those hearings is so diminished in the post-Bork world because it is about the least path of offense to anyone to be able to get onto the court. And I just think we are seeing that play out in real time.
And I totally agree. And the nominee, at the end of the day, he or she, their goal is to get the votes. That's really it. It's not about being consistent when you get onto the bench. It's about getting confirmed. And the reason why they can, of course, do that, the Supreme Court is one of those institutions, really the federal judiciary, where there is just no accountability for these judges and justices. They have a lifetime appointment, and they're not going to get impeached. They're not going to be removed by Congress. That's just not something that is a really a viable thing that will happen to a Supreme Court justice. So they can say what they want, and they can essentially do what they want. And they're the closest things they have in our society to the kings and queens almost.
Well, you know, on that point, there's an interesting article, an op-ed actually written by Anita Hill, about the idea of the confirmation being broken. I encourage people to read it because it really does talk about some of those. And I went back after I read the Alito opinion, the draft opinion that's not yet final. We have to keep saying that because it's what the Justice of the Supreme Court has said. But the idea of even the questions during his own confirmation hearing from the likes of the late Senator Ted Kennedy and others who were questioning the process as perfunctory even at that moment in time. So this is not just unique to the last three Supreme Court justice nominees, but it's also about what the American people value. Because, you know, I think you're going here, Fatima, as well. The Supreme Court's legitimacy is really contingent on people honoring the precedent, on saying, you know what, okay, they've said something, that's the law of the land. But as we've seen in places like Texas, when there was an end run around it, the expectation, even if it was outside of the abortion-related context, the expectation for much of the electorate was, hey, this deals with an area squarely within what is present precedent. So the Supreme Court would naturally defend its own precedent. And when we did not see that in the same degree, it raised many questions. I want to bring in another question and have you respond to it, Fatima, on this, because, and then I'm going to combine a couple of them here because they're on the same vein. And Roxanne from Connecticut has this issue, has this question. Tanya is also has this question. And it alludes to the idea of what will be next for other areas that are considered the fundamental rights, areas where it's within that zone of privacy, where the court is expected to make sure the government does not, you know, infringe or interfere or intrude on very private matters. And things like that, of course, include marriage and sexual relationships and contraceptives. And up until this draft opinion, things like abortion or even interstate travel. So with all of those fall under that same umbrella, Fatima, about what's a fundamental right, do you have concerns about what could be next?
I have giant concerns. I have giant concerns because it was just 2020 when the Supreme Court reaffirmed Roe's central holding. And the only thing that has shifted in that time between then and now is the composition of the court. I have giant concerns because really, if you read that draft opinion closely, it is tugging at not only the 50 years of Roe, but near 100 years of cases that go into the personal freedoms that you named. The idea that your own personal liberty can determine whether or not you have access to contraception, whether or not the government can tell you not to have a sexual relationship, whether or not you can marry who you want to, which, you know, whether we are talking about interracial marriages or we're talking about Obergefell. This line of cases and understanding about the personal freedoms that have connected one after another, Justice Alito's draft opinion sort of said, nowhere to be found in my view in the Constitution. And the only thing I'm left to do is to go back and think about what was the common law at the time, hundreds of years ago. Well, for those of us who were not fully protected at all, even by our original Constitution, that provides deep, horrific worries about what that means for our ability to be protected in the future. So I do not believe that it begins and ends with Roe. I do not believe it begins and ends with abortion access. I think the campaign from the other side, the campaign from the right, is a much larger long arc campaign.
Well, you know, on that point, I want to bring you into this, David, because in thinking about that, Because the retort, obviously, is that, look, he's not saying, this is Justice Alito, assuming it's a final draft, or these are his viewpoints, that his retort would be, I'm just returning it to the states. I'm allowing people to have the opportunity to participate in that which was never expected to be a spectator sport, democracy. And if the Supreme Court were to rule on an area where there is debate, well, then you're removing the ability of the electorate to be able to persuade or lobby their particular elected officials. And so what we're doing is returning it to the people's will. That's what's happening. Now, of course, it creates a patchwork of states where some would have more rights in some states than others, which is not totally unheard of in some areas of the law. But this would be one of the times where the court, in deciding to return to the people, is saying, look, I'm going to remove a fundamental right. What do you think the impact of that will be, David, if there are the concerns that Fatima is speaking about other issues being impacted, women's rights overall? I mean, women voters turn out.
They do, in greater number than male voters. That is true. What Fatima was describing, sort of the other areas of the broader privacy landscape, that's exactly what President Biden included in his first remarks on this leaked draft, indicating this is where Democrats plan to take this campaign. And you have to understand the context that this is happening in right now, right? Every single poll related to the 2022 midterms right now has shown a voter enthusiasm deficit for Democrats, and that Republicans are more enthusiastic about turning out and voting in this midterm election year. With this leaked draft opinion, it sort of dropped into the middle of that political context. Democrats are hoping to now take that and utilize it as a tool to engender enthusiasm, get their party alive and then awakened to show up and vote on this issue. I think the question is politically here, is this one issue going to be enough to overcome all the things that are creating this troubling political environment for Democrats? You know, inflation, real concerns about the economy, the president's standing. Can you overcome an overwhelming sense of the American people right now that things are not going in the right direction by using this issue and somehow making it the issue of the campaign? I think that's what Democrats are hoping to do, understanding they don't have a slew of options of all the other issues that are out there right now. I think the jury is still out on whether or not that can be a successful effort heading into November.
You know, Manu, go ahead, please. You don't have to wait for me, Manu. You know, you can do this. Go
ahead. I appreciate that. I can't hold back. I totally agree with what David's points and analysis are. And to add to that, which is remarkable, is just to see how the Republicans have view it, because they essentially are in agreement. They see this as an issue in which Democrats can drive out there, can close that enthusiasm gap. And which is why they don't want to embrace or talk much about the impacts of this draft ruling. Yesterday, one Republican after another either sidestepped questions, saying it was a draft and we don't want to get into the impacts of this, or criticized the leak itself as a fundamentally damaging to the institution, not what was in that leaked document. I mean, even the man who is central to essentially the 6-3 majority in the court, Mitch McConnell, held open a seat for a year, has spent decades trying to remake the court. This could be seen as a crowning achievement of his. I asked him yesterday, do you take personal credit for the fact that millions of Americans will not have access to abortion now? And he did not want to answer that question. All he said was, the news today is about the leak. That's it. And then in talking to the Republican campaign committee chairman, Rick Scott, I asked him, do you think abortion is going to be the driving issue heading into the midterms? And he said, no. He said the issue, in his view, inflation, crime, immigration, that's the suite of issues that Republicans want to run on. So this draft opinion, Democrats hope, can reset that narrative going forward, can offset all those other issues. That will be the big question. But for the Democrats, they can say, especially when they're running in the Senate races, we need to keep the Senate, because, of course, the Senate is the one that will confirm the next justice.
Manu, do you like it when the politicians you cover tell you what the news is?
Exactly. No, thank you. Thank you. Maybe you should become my editor.
You should go, actually, Senator, here, this is the news. Right. But on that point, I find it really interesting because on the one hand, for the reasons that you all have articulated, that this has been something that has been in the works. This has been a singular, at times, focus for, you know, certain Republicans and certain people on the spectrum of the Republican votes and electorate, and of course, those who are in office. It is surprising we don't see or are hearing more of a celebration at the prospect that this would or could be a final opinion, because it seems to be the culmination of the work that you speak of. And I'm wondering, on the backdrop of that, why it is that it might not be the midterm issue, as he spoke about. Is it because if this, in fact, is the final opinion, then there's no more need to campaign on this issue? Could both be true? What do you think, Fatima?
I'm totally confused how they think this is not a midterm issue. We are in a situation where there has been a long arc and an accelerated agenda to pack the court with justices who said they would overturn Roe. We are now at the point where that is going to happen, and happen even though 70% of this country don't want them to do it. And so this is the issue. The reason it hasn't been the issue before is because people in this country, rightly so perhaps, have such great trust in the fact that the court wouldn't do something like overturn 50 years of precedent and ignore the dramatic and deep harm that this will have, particularly for women's lives and futures. That is the future that we are facing. If this draft opinion becomes law, it will be real in for people in ways that I cannot even imagine. I was at the court last night with a lot of young women who were saying a version of, I never thought this is a thing I would have to fight for. They were focused on fighting for climate change. They were focused on fighting around policing. They thought this was decided 50 years ago by other people. It's here.
Fatima, on that point, there was a question. I want to raise a question for the audience about what you saw yesterday and we've all seen across. And I want to get right back to you, Manu. And that question was about the protester popping up. Do you expect that this will become a bigger movement like the Women's March or protests after the murder of George Floyd? And to bring that along with another question from Eric that asks, what can young people in the US do to support this movement? And thinking about both, will this be bigger? And if so, how can people be additive?
I think that this is going to continue to grow and grow. Oh, go ahead, Manu. But I do want to name that I think that this will be growing and growing as more and more people understand what is in front of them, and that they will be reacting in all the ways, including taking to the streets, putting pressure on their members of Congress and the administration and their state houses, that people are not going to just sit by and watch the erosion of their rights in this way.
Do you agree, Manu?
Yeah, and just to add, yeah, I do think that this is going to become, you'll see a lot more protests and demonstrations, and especially if this does become the law of the land, which we probably are going to know within the next few weeks, and that can maybe only intensify a lot of the very passionate feelings and we are seeing in the streets already. Now, I mean, the one thing that just to go back to the earlier point, Laura, that you asked about, you know, and how the Republicans are talking about this and campaigning on it, is that at the end of the day, you know, anger and fear motivate voters. And if you're a Republican who just are celebrating this major victory, you're not angry or fearful of anything, maybe overturning Roe v. Wade down the future, but you're celebrating this victory. It is not as much of a driving issue for their voters come the midterms, whereas Democratic voters will be very angry, already are very angry, will be fired up, and that's why you're going to see the two parties kind of position themselves accordingly in the months ahead.
That's a good point, the idea. I thought you said hangry at first. I was like, it's not even, it's past lunch. Who's hangry? I mean, I angry usually me. Am all angry the time. You never know. You never know. I turned to Joe Pesci without a Snickers bar, I guess. That all happens. But on that note, I just want to point out, Jennifer in Alabama asked the question of, have we heard of the Mother's Day strike? It's a huge movement on TikTok that some are calling for all American women to strike for 1 week, zero consumption of goods and services, zero work, zero sex, nothing at all. So there might be ways that TikTok is talking about these issues that we may not know about as well. I do want to ask a little bit from David, from your perspective on, and I want to ask you about TikTok, don't worry. He's like, no, don't do it. I'm asking about TikTok. But the question really is about, okay, if that's happening in a place like TikTok, is there room for a congressional sort of active, a kind of a protest of ignoring what the Supreme Court has to say? Or is there any advocacy or any ground to be gained in Congress essentially delegitimizing the court? There's a lot of risks in that. Is there some conversation about ignoring what is viewed as, at times, the public perception by some as a political entity?
I think most of that conversation, as such as it exists, has been in this push from the progressive left to expand the numbers on the court, right? To create sort of a court packing plan that you may recall President Biden tasked sort of a blue ribbon panel to look into. And they came back and advised the president that that would not be a wise recommendation. And it's something he was recently asked about again this week that he is not in favor of. But I don't think I have not heard of some movement on Capitol Hill, Manu, correct me if I'm wrong, to ignore the court's ultimate ruling here as if it didn't exist. But I do think there has been great political organization, though by great, I mean a lot of noise, I'm not in terms of success for them, around this notion of changing the court, its makeup, so that it is, as these progressives believe, more representative, because due to, they would argue, the filibuster rules before it didn't apply to a Supreme Court nomination, and the way that the Electoral College works, that the court is not representative of the people, and they would argue to expand it to allow it to be that. Again, that's going nowhere, so I don't really envision that much more than, at the moment, just an organizing, fundraising, activist tool that on the left.
And thank you to Kathy Kukanika for that question. Go ahead, please. Thank you for Kathy for that question. I think it was.
I was just going to say the legitimacy problem around the court has been echoed from inside the court. The justices on the court have raised giant concern around the use of the shadow docket, where the court makes big decisions without regular order and public transparency, or the fact that they're poised to overturn longtime precedent with no real analysis beyond the composition of the court changing. These are things that I actually think the Senate Judiciary Committee has to think about in a serious way. It is a critical issue, in my view.
And look, the Democrats just are concerned about really embracing the court expansion issue, because the issue has been, you know, the Republicans were the ones campaigning against court packing. You saw Joe Biden dance around this issue in the campaign in 2020. And the Democratic caucus is not united on this. John Tester, one of the Democrats from in the caucus from Montana, told me today he still opposes the idea of expanding the size of the Supreme Court. And Chuck Schumer has not made this a priority at all, at least in the messaging too, in the aftermath of this draft decision. So that's one reason why you're not gonna really see a whole lot of push among Democratic leaders to embrace this, because they know they're not totally in line on this issue.
Important point. I want to conclude with just two points that are raised by our audience and ask you all for your final thoughts on what people can start thinking about as to what happens now and what they should see or start thinking about on the horizon. And one point from John was asking about the consequences of the fallout of the leak itself, why we know about this draft opinion. And I've heard many lawyers who are talking about this notion of, you know, the consequences of the fallout of that leak will be along how they actually got it. Knowing how it was actually obtained will be the key to the sort of criminal code city if there is a violation or illegality. We don't yet know, but we are all very curious about that. And finally, it ends another question here, and it was from Joan in Arizona, who said, I have friends and family who were injured or died from illegal abortions. How do I let the court know the need for legal, safe abortions? And really, it comes back full circle to how we began this conversation about Roe v. Wade was not the beginning of abortions in this country, and it will. And if this final opinion is in fact, or if this opinion becomes final, it won't be the end of unplanned pregnancies. So dealing with these issues and knowing about the need for safe access to healthcare, given those things, each of you, please give me a quick final thoughts on where you think this issue is going to go next. David?
I'll start by just saying, look to your state legislatures, because if indeed this is going back to the states and Roe is overturned, a lot of the, I know we were talking about Congress codifying or not and the votes out there, but a lot of the action is now going to be in the state legislatures and in the governor's offices across the land. That's where this piece by piece is going, state by state, is going to be hammered out.
Fatima?
I just think we're at a time where people are going to be asking in the future, where were you when they came for Roe and when they began the unraveling of so many of our personal freedoms and protections? And I think that's going to drive people in this country to act.
Manu?
Yeah, I want to echo David's point. I was going to say something very similar, that, yeah, there's a lot of talk on the federal level, and of course the Senate plays the role in confirming the Supreme Court justice, so the midterms are incredibly important depending on how you view this issue. But so often so many voters overlook what's happening in their state legislatures, who their state legislators are, and don't focus enough on that. Even that has more a direct impact, particularly on an issue like this. So pay attention and vote, because it matters.
I want to thank you all. I'm sorry that our time is coming to an end, but it's a really appropriate place to conclude. We're talking about Citizen by CNN, Roe v. Wade, what happens next? Perhaps that answer is up to all of you. So thank you for joining, and thank you to our wonderful panel. Thank you.
Thanks.
Thank you.